Hello, everyone, and welcome to Under the Umbrella, a panel about shedding light on some of the many identities that are under the umbrella within the LGBTQIA+ community. My name is Vanessa Peterson, and I am the secretary of the H.E.R.O. Club. H.E.R.O. is an acronym that stands for Helping Educate Regarding Orientation, and we're the LGBTQIA+ Club here on the Fall River BCC campus. An umbrella term is a word or phrase that is used in reference to a variety of different but related terms, such as how science may refer to both biology and chemistry. Though if you've ever had a chance to take those classes, you know that they're very different subjects. You may also say that LGBTQ+ is an umbrella term that itself encompasses many individuals who openly identify as many different things. Cisgender, now here is your first vocabulary term of the day. It refers to having your sexual identity conform to the gender that you were born with, your biological sex. This means that if you were born with a penis, you consider yourself male, and if you were born with a vagina, then you consider yourself female. Now, there are many people who don't conform to this. Those who see the gender binary as incorrect in itself is there are more than two genders. There is, in fact, a spectrum of more than just female to masculine, and there are more than two genders that lie between your legs. We do have a few people who will be giving more insight into this. There are many terms related to sex, sexuality, and sexual identity and orientation, but again, we're going to talk about them. Now, to provide a little background, I'd like to introduce a term that many of us here hold near and dear. Many of you probably know what that is, even if you've never heard of the word before. Heteronormativity. Heteronormativity is the thought, opinion, or assumption that heterosexuality is the only normal, correct, or acceptable sexual orientation, and that all others are strange, wrong, or unacceptable. Heteronormativity has been a long-held standard propagated through history by religion, politics, media, cultural, social, and gender roles. But I think that the very root of this comes from science. Most species of this planet have had the natural instinct to procreate. To produce offspring, and to keep species going to ensue its survival. And as for humans, the only pair that can naturally produce offspring is a heterosexual couple. That's basic science. It's bio 101, and it's just nature. But it's also natural for some people to be incapable of reproduction. It's natural for some people to not want offspring, and it's natural for some people to simply never reproduce throughout their entire lives. It's perfectly natural for some people to not be heterosexual. It's natural, normal, and okay for some people to be homosexual, just as it's natural, normal, and okay for people to be pansexual, asexual, demisexual, etc. And if I stood here and listed all the different orientations and sexual orientations that are out there, I would use up this whole panel. My point is that the idea, opinion, or assumption that one orientation or identity is correct and one orientation or others is wrong is a problem that needs to be addressed. And as our culture grows and matures, it's important to know and not only understand that this is this, but also to gain an understanding into what else is out there. And this is why we're here today, to offer insight into some of these other orientations and identities that are natural and correct, just as being straight or cisgender. Myself and the members of our club that you see here have worked very hard over the past month to put together the presentation that you see today, drawing from our own experiences, research, and stories from friends, and to bring you insight into what it's like to live under this umbrella, like we all do, each in our own way. I'll ask you to please hold any questions for our speakers till the very end, when we open for discussion. Without further ado, I would like to introduce our president, Lyon.
Hello, everyone.
Okay.
Like ranges of color, gender identity is a spectrum. At one end, there's black, and at the other, there's white. Yet there are infinite hues and shades that hold a place in their own in that spectrum. My name is Lion Macedo, and I'm president of the H.E.R.O. Club, and I identify as gender fluid. Gender fluidity is a non-binary gender identity in which an individual's gender changes over time. In my own words, a gender fluid person is someone who can feel feminine one day, masculine the next, or completely neutral altogether. As a gender fluid individual, it is very difficult to assign pronouns to myself. For a long time, I was very passive about specifying my pronouns. Not because I didn't care, but more because I didn't have enough faith in others to respect my identity enough to use the pronouns of my choosing, no matter what I told others. However, nowadays, I have become more adamant about using they-them pronouns to describe myself because I'm proud of the gender I am, and I want others to start to learn and educate themselves about different genders. More often than not, people get confused on how to use they-them pronouns, and even after practicing using them, it really does take time to get used to, I should know. In theory, using these pronouns shouldn't be that much of a change. Yet, as students, ever since preschool, we have been conditioned to use he and she as pronouns to identify a single individual, and they to identify a group of people. Because of this, when being faced with using they-them pronouns, our brains kind of glitch, and we stutter because we realize that the person in front of us is one single individual, yet because of how English works, we try and use they-them as a group. So why use these gender pronouns? In actuality, they-them are pronouns that are described as neutral. They do not assign gender to the individual. All my life, ever since I was a young kid, I was labeled as a tomboy by adults. I loved nothing more than roughhousing with my brother and climbing trees. Even though I pretended I preferred activities and toys that were targeted as traditionally female, I also liked feminine things like stuffed animals or Polly Pockets. Although dresses and anything pink were always out of the question, and definitely still are. This dynamic didn't seem to be odd as a little kid, yet as I got older, I realized it was considered weird that I enjoyed both male and female things. I didn't learn about what gender fluid was until I was 15 years old, and as soon as I did, I felt like it all made sense. I finally had a word to explain why I could feel like wearing lots of makeup and lacy dresses one day, wake up the next and feel like nothing fit right without binding my chest or using something to make it look smaller, or just felt like nothing at all fit at all the next few days and feel completely uncomfortable. Which leads to another problem gender fluids face, dysphoria. Dysphoria, in this instance, is a condition of feeling discomfort and unease in one's own skin. The very first time I remember feeling dysphoric was when I was 6 or 7 years old, very young, and my grandmother had taken my brother and I to the toy store. I remember a worker approaching me and asking if I would like the princess toys or the truck toys, and my little mind went completely blank. Not because I didn't know what toy I wanted, but because I was unsure of what gender I was feeling. There aren't many recorded studies regarding gender fluidity and dysphoria because of how different each gender fluid individual can feel or experience the fluctuations of identity, but many of the gender fluids that I've spoken with over the years have reported feeling dysphoric at one time or another. One individual I spoke to in my quest for research reported that in this person's teens, they felt such a strong sense of dysphoria, such unease and sickening discomfort, that it was painful enough for them to almost take their life. To put this into perspective for you, I could wake up one day feeling dysphoric and not want to leave the house and just be uncomfortable all day, but for some people who are gender fluid, it's more than that. It's a lot more painful, and sometimes it could almost be enough to make people take their life. This is a mass stigma surrounding this gender identity, ranging from society thinking that it doesn't exist and that it's an insult to gender binary, to the idea that It's a term that's been made up to make people feel special. Gender fluidity has almost always been recognized in the psychiatric field, but biologists need a little convincing. Thanks to a neuroscientist, Simon Levay, we know that there is, in fact, a chemical and structural difference between heterosexual brains and homosexual brains, in which concluded finally in 1991 that people are, yes, definitely born homosexual. But what about gender fluid? A few years ago, the Medical University of Vienna issued a press release that stated that the gender identity that exists in the brain of every single human is reflected and verifiable in the cross-sections between brain regions, specifically in ranges of chemicals that exist in white matter. In simpler terms, that means the neuroscientist George S. Kranz, there is more than enough biological proof to show that the world that neurological gender, the gender that one feels in their mind, is also one that develops and overwrites biological sex, the gender one was born into. When I share my identity with people, sometimes the question they ask is, well, why can't you just be a girl and dress like a girl? It's so much easier. Why can't you just do that? That's such a difficult question to answer, mainly because, yeah, I could do that, and sometimes I do. Sometimes I feel like a female and I'll dress more feminine. But most of the time, if I had just dressed like a girl and made sure everyone called me by female pronouns, I'd be living a life of a lie. I would feel uncomfortable every day dressing in traditional female wear and doing what traditional females are expected to do. But that's not who I am. I'm not a female, I'm not a male, I'm gender fluid. Thank you.
Hello, my name is Caitlin Ann Habib. I'm a freshman here at BCC and I identify as a lesbian. In the LGBTQ community, a lesbian is a person who feels emotional, romantic, and sexual feelings for other women. And in the LGBTQI plus community, lesbian is a huge umbrella term that most people are already familiar with. However, newer individuals' understanding of the word is highly stereotyped. For example, there's a very prevalent myth that almost all lesbians are butch or very masculine, but that's pretty far from the truth because in like all communities, lesbians come in all different shapes, sizes, and colors. And what this stereotype basically says is that feminine girls can't be gay because they're too pretty to be gay. And that's a really unfair assumption because a lot of people don't automatically assume a tomboy to be gay, but almost always assume a feminine girl to be straight, which kind of erases the femi-lesbian identity. Based upon my own experiences, I believe that the vast majority of lesbians fall somewhere in the middle of the spectrum of the butch to femme spectrum. Personally, I like to wear boy-oriented clothes, but every once in a while, I like to get glammed up and look really pretty. So somebody couldn't really classify me as either butch or femme. There's also this myth that all lesbian relationships are between a dominant boyish girl and a feminine submissive woman, which is pretty ridiculous because that's not really true in like heterosexual relationships. I know plenty of straight couples where the woman is far more dominant than the man. I find this stereotype to be one of the most offensive because this perception of lesbianism is a very heteronormative view of the world. It's like almost saying that all gay relationships are trying to mirror the man-woman dynamic that is commonly found in hetero relationships. Sexual orientation has very little bearing on an individual's style and preference. Those things are entirely separate. Another tall tale is that all lesbians are man-haters. But when you think about it, the only people who tend to consistently complain about men are straight women. Newsflash, lesbians don't care. In general, people only hate others when they're not getting something they need from the other person or anything else is just find that person super annoying. I also want to add that not all lesbians share men's assumed love of sports. I suck at sports, and I can't be the only lesbian that does. I'm one of those people who try to play sports and really wanted to be good at it, but almost always ended up getting hurt. In high school, I made the basketball team, And I played a few games, but then a ball came and like hit me really hard in the face. Out of that, I was like, I'm gonna run track. That's probably better, less dangerous. Did a couple runs, then I ended up tripping really, really bad and sprained both my knees. After that, I was like, I'm not doing sports anymore. I'm accident prone. I'm gonna get real hurt. So that's why I really just dread Thanksgiving, because my cousins always like, go, come on, Kaylin, play. You can do it. You know, you're awesome. And I'm just like, nah, guys, I'm good. And it's just really annoying because they never like pressure my cousin Kelsey to play or my sister Chelsea to play. Nope, just me, because I'm super gay and that somehow qualifies me as a sports prodigy. A lot of people say that lesbians are super fanatical about cats. Like, I don't hate cats, they're cool, but like, I'm more of a dog person. I got like 3 puppies at home. Their name is Boss, Diamond, and Bambi. Being the ultra awesome homosexual I am, it's pretty chill, I'm not gonna lie, because honestly, who wants to be normal? That's boring. I'd rather be different, despite the changes that come with being different, because I like to being my truest self, and I'm not willing to ever compromise that for anybody. I am who I am, and I don't fit with a mold that is a stereotypical lesbian, and I'm pretty sure a lot of other lesbians feel the same way. No two people are the same, and that's why stereotypes and social norms aren't just wrong, but harmful. So in conclusion, don't try to be a person that people expect you to be. Be your own unique individual, because being yourself is way better than following the crowd. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Vanessa Peterson, and I'm bisexual. There are many ways to define bisexuality today, as each individual's sexuality is complicated and beautiful. So between each individual who describes himself as bi, there can be some differences. A definition of bisexuality that I'm particularly fond of is one by Robin Ox, an LGBTQIA+ activist and an editor of several notable pieces about bi awareness. The definition is this: the potential to be attracted romantically and or sexually to people of more than one sex and or gender, not necessarily at the same time, not necessarily in the same way, and not necessarily to the same degree. In my opinion, bisexuality is probably the most well-known of the many different types of multigender attraction, and also what I like to call one of the main identities. What I mean by this is that people generally know what you're talking about when I say, I'm bisexual. This can be both a blessing and a curse, as having a sexuality everyone knows about means that everyone already has their own opinions. I'm lucky that when I realized I was definitely not straight, as my friends and I would joke when we were questioning, was that when I found the word bisexual, is that it fit me well. This is not the case for many people. I know many people personally who refuse to claim an identity because the idea of a label is irksome. Others who broadcast their identities proudly, and yet still more who are continuing to search for the proper word to describe what they feel inside. Everyone has a story to tell, and some are long and twisting. My story is rather uneventful, which seems tragically millennial in its lack of drama. In middle school, I started using the internet more and was faced with the agonizing process of what to type in the various about me sections of social media sites. I would typically type, I don't care what's in your pants, only what's in your heart. I would have long conversations with my friends at sleepovers, which would involve screeches of laughter and lots of silliness. But late in the night, sleep deprived and having real talk about our crushes and thoughts about the future, I would often admit the romantic notion that if I truly fell in love with a girl, then I would marry her. And if it was a boy, then that would be cool too. Which, comfortingly, was a sentiment that many of my friends echoed. It took another few years for it to dawn on me after another friend came out as bi, and after considering why I always felt compelled to explain that I was more interested in loving someone for their personality than their body, that it occurred to me, oh wow, I'm bi. I'm 21 years old now, confident in who I am sexually, and have considered myself bisexual since freshman year of high school. It wasn't always this way, however. I was hesitant to broadcast my newfound sexuality, and I wasn't really sure why. Maybe it was because this was personal and special to me, and only my close friends deserved to know. Why did anyone else need to? As I got older, I realized through the attitudes of people around me, the internet, TV, you name it, I'd learned that things that weren't strictly straight were somehow kinky or dirty, and that I needed to keep this information to myself. But I went with my gut and I told my friends, which I'm forever glad for. Keeping a secret like that about myself would have eaten me up inside. We formed a pretty tight support group, which got us through the hell that was puberty and high school. Many of us are still in contact today. Despite having my friends to back me up, though, I was still a hormonal teenager and was not nearly as confident with my sexuality then as I am now. I knew how I felt, but not how others would perceive me, nor how to proceed my romantic relationships. My first encounter with prejudice against my sexuality was in high school, when I started dating one of my close friends. One of my other friends asked me, "So, how does he feel about you being bi? Isn't he afraid you're gonna cheat on him or something?" I was hurt and confused. And the more I talked with this friend, the more they explained that this was a pretty common attitude and people didn't trust bisexuals. Something that they were, well, they seemed to forget that they were talking to someone who was bisexual and that it was still me. This is probably the attitude that's the most hurtful. That the idea that simply because of my sexuality, it makes me more likely to cheat on my partner. This is an awful stereotype, one that's absolutely false. How someone conducts themselves in a relationship in terms of how faithful they are has much less to do with their sexuality and much more to do with their moral values and how the two people are in a relationship as a whole. The attitude that I most persistently encounter, however, is that of, "Why don't you just pick one?" As if being attracted to more than one gender is being greedy or fickle. For example, a few years ago, when I confided in a friend that I had feelings for a female, they laughed and asked, "So are you a lesbian now?" I replied, "No, I'm still bi." They apologized, saying they were hoping I just made up my mind. Every relationship is different, and the dynamic between partners is ever-changing and challenging. In a healthy relationship, you grow and learn more about each other as a couple the longer you're together, no matter what you identify as. I was lucky enough to meet someone who, though they didn't share the same views as me when we met, was open-minded and willing to learn. Now we're engaged to be married and have been together for 4 years this September. I'm truly blessed to have met such a wonderful person and can actually thank Lion for introducing us. I remember the first conversation with my fiancé I had about my sexuality. It was the night he came over to date my family. We were sitting on my back porch playing 20 questions, which quickly devolved into sharing things that we thought were important, and then asking follow-up questions. He told me he was a devout Christian, but not to judge, because it was more complicated than that. I told him that I was bisexual, but not to judge, because it was more complicated than that. We shared many more secrets, and after that first conversation, we gained a better understanding that we were more than the comic book nerd and Manny Pixie Dream Girl than we thought each other to be. In all honesty, I was trepidatious about his religious beliefs from what I had read about religious people's attitudes towards gay people, just as he was trepidatious about me being bi from what he had heard about bi people from various sources. But we really liked each other, and we were willing to give it a go. We both hated being judged for these facets of our personality in the past because they were a big part of who we were, but they weren't the only thing about us. Over the years, I've accepted him for who he is and he for who I am. He's one of my best friends, my partner in everything, and amazingly supportive in all I do. He's my other half, and soon he's going to be my husband. What's interesting thing, though, is that other people are often confused when they hear that I'm getting married. Ask me questions like, "So you're straight now, right?" And of course, when I reply, "No, I'm still bi," they often scoff and reply with, "Really?" And say things like, "I mean, does it really matter at this point?" To which generally I just sigh and change the subject because I'm not that fond of confrontation. Unfortunately, whenever I've received such lines of questioning, they've been in high-stress situations without much opportunity for me to compose an innocuous answer. If I'd had the time and wherewithal to prepare myself for such a question, like I have now, I would tell those people that, of course it matters. It's part of my identity. Being bisexual is as integral to who I am as my love for colorful hair, my struggle with my fainting spells in the past, and that I make sure to state that I'm originally from Texas whenever the opportunity presents itself. I do not cling to my identity as bisexual because I foresee a future with different or multiple partners, but because it still describes who I am. It frustrates and upsets me when I'm questioned about the validity of my identity, as if my sexuality were something for people to scrutinize. Because in all honesty, the fact that people who question me about this hadn't considered the countless conversations I've had with my partner about this is sort of beyond me. Though I will always respond to those who ask questions about my identity with patience and grace, I realize that sometimes people who ask questions honestly don't really want to hear what I have to say. Though it can be discouraging, I just have to remind myself that I don't really owe people my time or energy. Instead, I can focus on those who do want to hear what I have to say, and that I can focus my energy on things that I do here at BCC and spreading awareness and acceptance through the H.E.R.O. Club. Thank you.
Hi, I'm Caitlin Louise Sylvia, and I'm a lesbian. This is my journey about me going from being bisexual to being a lesbian. A bisexual is someone that is sexually attracted to both men and women. What bisexual means to me is someone that has sexual, romantic, and emotional feelings towards both the same and opposite sex. A lesbian is a homosexual woman. What lesbian means to me is a woman that has sexual, romantic, and emotional attraction towards another girl or woman. In the beginning of my journey to find my sexuality orientation, I thought that I was bisexual. I was in the eighth grade in middle school. I don't know what love really was or if I could even fall in love. I didn't even know that I could have a crush on both a boy or a girl. So I was thinking and thought to myself, could I really be having feelings for both boys and girls? So I did some research on it and I found out that I could have both the same feelings and crushes on both boys and girls. I also found out that it was a sexuality called bisexual. I wasn't so confused after I found that out. Before I told my best friend that I was bisexual, I was so nervous about what she was going to say and what was going to happen to our friendship. So after I told her that I was bisexual, she did the total opposite of what I was going to think what was going to happen. She said, "You know that isn't a bad thing, right? And I am also okay that you're bisexual, and I am still your best friend." I was surprised when she said that to me, because I thought that she wouldn't be my best friend or friend anymore. I went to school the following day. I was super nervous because I was finally going to ask out my crush. And I was super nervous, that scared, because I was worried about what if she was either going to call me a freak and say no, or if she was going to say yes, she would be my girlfriend. I was shaking and stuttering when I asked her out. After I asked her out, she just so happened to say yes. I was relieved when she said yes. She also said to me, "Why are you being so nervous and scared to ask me out?" "Because I wanted to ask you out as well." We were both happy and excited the most when we were dating, because we found out that we had most of the same classes together. When we both graduated from middle school, we didn't have much time to see and spend time together because I was summertime. When the summer ended and high school began, I was so excited because I finally got to see her and she finally got to see me. But when we saw each other, She didn't even come up to me and hug or kiss me. It was like she either A, forgotten over the summer that we were even dating, or B, that she didn't even want anyone to know that we were dating. I was really sad and upset about both of the ideas that I was having and thinking was going on. So I went up to her and pulled her aside and I asked her, why are you acting like we aren't dating anymore? And I felt then she answered by saying, we can't date anymore. I felt my heart drop and I said, why? And she just walked away without saying anything to me about it. I kept that I was bisexual after that for all of high school. It was both a good and upsetting idea that I did. It was a good idea because I have seen and found out through my little time there that everyone that wasn't straight got bullied, harassed, pushed, picked on, and beaten up because they were different. I felt really scared, worried, upset, and nervous. I was worried and nervous about what if they found out that I was bisexual? What would they do to me? I was so relieved and excited when I graduated because I didn't have to deal with being scared and hiding my sexuality anymore. When I first started here at BCC for my first semester in September of 2013, I found out that I could be out and proud about my sexuality because everyone accepts you here for no matter what your sexuality it was. I found out that there was and still is an LGBTQIA+ club here, which is known as H.E.R.O Club. And ever since I joined, I felt more safer here and I feel a lot better with everyone knowing about my sexuality. For my seventh semester this past year, I was part of the BCC women's soccer team. I started to have feelings for one of the girls on the team. She started to have feelings for me, too. We started to flirt with each other. After the second to last game of the season, we finally got into a relationship. For our first 3 months together of our relationship, I still thought to myself that I was still bisexual. She started questioning my sexuality from the beginning of our relationship. But though the end of our fourth month and beginning of our fifth month together, she helped me realize I dated more girls than guys. I had more of sexual and romantic feelings for girls more than guys. That's when I finally realized and figured out why I never felt romantically and sexually attracted to guys as I do girls. Because I wasn't bisexual, I am actually a lesbian. This is my journey on how I started my sexuality from being bisexual and finally realizing that I am actually and truly a lesbian. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Taylor. I'm a trans woman. And here we go. What is it like to be trans? This is a question I've heard more times than I care to count, and I've always responded the same way. Oh, you know, it's a whole thing. I never really put too much thought into the question. What does it mean to be trans? Well, the dictionary definition is denoting or relating to a person whose sense of personal identity and gender does not correspond to their birth sex. For me, it's really just been about my transition and moving forward. I didn't begin questioning my gender identity until I was in high school, when I began to understand that transitioning was an option. It was my sophomore year and I was about 16. I knew I wanted to transition, and trying to be something I wasn't made me miserable, and it had for years. Prior to then, I could never nail down what was wrong, and I had always known something was off. It took until I was 21 when depression and anxiety had spun way out of control, and I found myself in the hospital to finally come out to my parents and start my transition. Since the beginning, my transition has made my life improve, just consistently. But unfortunately, it's not all sunshine and rainbows. And at the beginning, it was riddled with aggravation and uncertainty. Certain challenges have presented themselves throughout the last 2 years. And just for a taste, I'll share a couple of those with you now. The first one isn't so bad. I've often been asked, what bathroom do I use? And for the first 11 months of hormone therapy, I stuck with the men's room, simply because I wasn't comfortable going into the women's room. That was largely due to the fact that I still looked like a man and answered to my old name. And that brings us to question number two. What's your old name? Before any of you ask, you can't know. It's connected to my old identity and just doesn't carry any more relevance. There are appropriate questions to ask, and I think part of that is knowing what they are. A good example might be, what pronouns do you prefer? And a quick Google search should provide good information on the subject. And when you ask, just make sure not to push people on questions that they might not be comfortable with. Now, these things have been easy to deal with, and they aren't anything compared to the more extreme challenges faced by the community. Now, I don't personally talk about this stuff too much, because it's not something I enjoy talking about. I don't really want it to be a prevalent feature in my life. But people have, and I'm sure will, come up to me and say nasty things about trans people. I personally have stopped going to places in my hometown to avoid specific levels of harassment. And one situation occurred outside of my town on a train home from Boston. There were two gentlemen on the train. One of them said, "She doesn't, I'm going to say something." And the other one immediately replied, "That's not a she." The first one came up to me, said excuse me, and began telling me how he thought that I looked like an actress that I can't remember. He was perfectly polite and continued using the right pronouns as his friend glared at us for the rest of the time he was on the train, which understandably made me just a little uncomfortable. Thankfully, the first guy was there to ignore his friend and continue being a decent individual. Sadly, all situations don't end on such a moderate note. And statistics aren't on our side. 41% of trans people have attempted suicide. Trans people are 4 times more likely to have an income less than $10,000. And 90% of trans people have had to face discrimination of some form due to their trans status. And this might be the scariest one, but the life expectancy of a trans person is only 30 to 35 years. Now, those are some scary statistics, but it's not all being trans is. Do we face challenges? Yes, but we can't let those challenges and fears keep us from being who we are. Being transgender is a whole thing, and sometimes it's hard and bigots make us worry. But we can't stop fighting. Statistics can change and minds can change. Being trans is about living your true self, and that's a beautiful thing. Thank you.
For our last story, I have a essay that one of our club members didn't feel comfortable reading themselves today and asked me if they would have me read it. Sex. Sex is a fun word to say. I'm just kidding. I'm not here to talk about sex, though you're gonna hear me say it a lot, and it is important to us, our society, our culture, and even our species. The very act of sexual intercourse is how we reproduce, how we pass on our claim to the planet. Many of our marriage laws were originally written for the sake of ensuring future offspring. And therefore, marriage was solidified with an act of sex, which is called consummating the marriage, as we, most of us, should know. However, we are one of the only two creatures in the world known to have recreational sex. That is casual sex for pleasure. The other one is dolphins. That's neither here nor there, though. Just a fun fact. And our society recognizes this. Sex sells. Why else would we put so much value on our standards of beauty, have clothing advertisements with naked models, or the movie 50 Shades of Grey? Yikes. Sex is an important part of who we are, how we define ourselves, and how we see others. We are in the midst of sexual revolution. Laws and social norms have and continue to be challenged in hopes of granting equality to those who never fit the traditional standards of sex, those who are not heteronormative or cisgender. But what about those who don't fit any standard of sex? What about those who view sex as not being an important part of who they are or how they see themselves and others? Let's talk about something very important to me. Let's talk about asexuality. When we break down the term asexuality, we get the prefix a, meaning no or none, and sexuality, which I know can be broken down, but we kind of already know what that is. An asexual person is defined as lack of sexual orientation, or lack of sexual attraction, rather. I never just felt it. I didn't understand because I wasn't interested. No one made me feel like I wanted that. I kept thinking, you're too young and you don't know what you're talking about, which eventually became, okay, maybe I'm just a late bloomer. And then ultimately, am I even straight? So I was questioning for a very long time, and to be honest, I still kind of am. But I know I must be on the asexual spectrum because I know I haven't felt sexual attraction. It's hard to identify yourself as lacking something you've never felt. Sexual attraction and how it's experienced may differ from person to person, but as I understand it, the attraction is clear when it's experienced. Most people know if and when they've experienced sexual attraction. Demisexuality.org puts it nicely. Sexual attraction isn't something you can control. Either you have sexual feelings for someone or not. You can't force it to happen, and you can't force it to go away. So you don't have a choice in the matter. Asexuals might understand what attraction is, such as thinking someone is good-looking, which is aesthetic attraction, or wanting to get to know somebody better, or wanting to closer relationship with a person, which could be romantic attraction. But most asexuals won't feel the need to act on that attraction in a sexual way. Asexuality is different than celibacy. Celibacy is the choice not to engage in sexual activities. Now, some asexuals can and do feel arousal. We can and will masturbate. Maybe the concept of a rock-hard penis or a warm-tight vagina intrigues you, or maybe it doesn't matter at all. Excuse me. Asexuals might have these opinions as well, but these opinions will not motivate an asexual's choice or personality the way it might motivate others. We don't always associate arousal with needing or wanting sex or needing a partner for sexy fun times. Their words, not mine. That being said, asexuals can and do have relationships. We have the same emotional needs as anyone else. Our relationships are based on communication, closeness, fun, and trust, just like anyone else. We do have some small communities, the most prominently being AVEN, the Asexual Visibility Education Network, with 91,530 members on English forums. There are other communities on Tumblr, Facebook, LiveJournal, if people still use that, I'm really not sure, and even YouTube. But there's still not much solid data available on asexuality. There are too many inaccuracies and misconceptions, which are often accepted as truths and experiences, can be very varied throughout the identity spectrum, which is of any identity, really, but especially this one, since it also doubles as a spectrum itself. We may only comprise 1% of the populace, but keep in mind that still 7,000,000 people out of 7 billion, I'm doing the math correctly, so she says. Before I leave you, I wanted to share a couple quotes on asexuality with you. Bella DiPaolo from the Psychology Today website states, "Taking asexuality seriously is a very big deal. To document a sizable number of people who do not experience sexual attraction is to challenge one of the most fundamental assumptions of contemporary society, that sexuality is pervasive, a given, as essential part of what it is to be human." And from David Jay, the founder of AVEN, "We think that if your goal is to create an open, honest dialogue about sexuality, you should be talking about asexuality too. By celebrating sexuality, you should also be celebrating the fact that sex is sometimes boring and that there are other ways to connect with people. We live in a very sexual world. For those of us who identify as aces, asexuals, who don't feel sexual attraction the way the rest of the world does, we are made to feel out of place, alien, when there's nothing wrong with us at all. We as a society are in the midst of sexual revolution. While the voices of asexuals may not be as loud as the voices of others in the community, the words of a blogger called The Thinking Asexual, we live in sexual liberty society, not liberated one. A truly liberated society is one where sex is value neutral and not having sex is just acceptable, it's having a lot of it. While our norms are adjusting to recognize homosexuals, bisexuals, trans, and so many others, shouldn't asexuals be recognized too? Thank you.
I'd like to thank you all for coming today. I think that went very well.